Beauty by Anna Sewell. Read by Anne-Lise Kadri. Chapter 35. Jerry Barker. I never knew a better man than my new master. Kind and good, as strong for the right as John Manley, and as good-tempered and merry that very few people could pick a quarrel with him. He was very fond of making little songs which he would sing to himself. His favourite was this. Come, father and mother and sister and brother, come all of you turn to help one another. And so they did. Harry was as clever at stable work as a much older boy, and always wanted to do what he could. Then Polly and Dolly used to come in the morning to help with the cab, to brush and beat the cushions and rub the glass, while Jerry was giving us a cleaning in the yard and Harry was cleaning the harness. There used to be a great deal of laughing and fun between them, and it put Captain and me in much better spirits than if we heard scolding and hard words. They were always early in the morning, for Jerry would say, "If you in the morning throw minutes away, you can't pick them up in the course of the day. You may hurry and scurry, and flurry and worry. You've lost them forever, for ever and aye." He could not bear any careless loitering and waste of time, and nothing was so near making him angry as to find people who were always running late, wanting a cab horse to be driven hard to make up for their idleness. One day, two wild-looking young men came out of a tavern close by the stand and called Jerry. "Here, cabby, look sharp. We're rather late. Put on the steam, will you, and take us to Victoria in time for the 1 o'clock train. You shall have a shilling extra."
"I will take you at the regular pace, gentlemen. Shillings don't pay for putting on the steam like that."
Larry's cab was standing next to ours. He flung open the door and said,
"I'm your man, gentlemen. Take my cab. My horse will get you there all right."
And as he shut them in with a wink towards Jerry, he said,
"It's against his conscience to go beyond a jog trot."
Then, slashing his jaded horse, he set off as hard as he could. Jerry patted me on the neck.
"No, Jack, a shilling would not pay for that sort of thing, would it, old boy?"
Although Jerry was steadfastly set against hard driving to please careless people, he always went at a good fair pace, and was not against putting on the steam, as he said, if only he knew why. I well remember one morning, as we were on the stand waiting for a fare, that a young man carrying a heavy portmanteau trod on a piece of orange peel which lay on the pavement and fell down with great force. Jerry was the first to run and lift him up. He seemed much stunned, and as they led him into a shop, he walked as if he were in great pain. Jerry, of course, came back to the stand, but in about 10 minutes one of the shopmen called him, so he drew up to the pavement.
"Can you take me to the South Eastern Railway?" said the young man. "This unlucky fall has made me late, I fear, but it is of great importance that I should not lose the 12 o'clock train. I should be most thankful if you could get me there in time, and will gladly pay you an extra fare."
"I'll do my very best," said Jerry heartily. "If you think you're well enough, sir," for he looked dreadfully white and ill.
"I must go," he said earnestly. "Please open the door and let us lose no time." The next minute Jerry was on the box. He gave a cheery chirrup to me and a twitch to the rein that I well understood.
"Now then, Jack, my boy," said he, "spin along. We'll show them how we can get over the ground if we only know why."
It is always difficult to drive fast in the city in the middle of the day, when the streets are full of traffic, but we did what could be done, and when a good driver and a good horse who understand each other are of one mind, it is wonderful what they can do. I had a very good mouth, that is, I could be guided by the slightest touch of the rein, and that is a great thing in London, amongst carriages, omnibuses, carts, vans, trucks, cabs, and great wagons creeping along at a walking pace, some going one way, some another, some going slowly, others wanting to pass them, omnibuses stopping short every few minutes to take up a passenger, obliging the horse that is coming behind to pull up too, or to pass and get before them. Perhaps you try to pass, but just then something else comes dashing in through the narrow opening, and you have to keep in behind the omnibus again. Presently, you think you see a chance and manage to get to the front, going so near the wheels on each side that half an inch nearer and they would scrape. Well, you get along for a bit, but you soon find yourself in a long train of carts and carriages, all obliged to go at a walk. Perhaps you come to a regular block-up and have to stand still for minutes together, till something clears out into a side street, or the policeman interferes, or you have to be ready for any chance to dash forward if there be an opening,
and be quick as a rat dog to see if there be room, and if there be time, lest you get your own wheels locked or smashed, or the shaft of some other vehicle run into your chest or shoulder. All this is what you have to be ready for. If you want to get through London fast in the middle of the day, it wants a deal of practice. Jerry and I were used to the thickest traffic, and no one could beat us at getting through when we were set on it. I was quick and bold, and could always trust my driver. Jerry was quick and patient at the same time, and could trust his horse, which was a great thing, too. He very seldom used the whip. I knew by his voice and his click, click, when he wanted to get on fast, and the rein told me where I was to go, so there was no need for whipping. The streets were very full that day, but we got on pretty well as far as the bottom of Cheapside, where there was a block for 3 or 4 minutes. The young man put his head out and said anxiously, "I think I'd better get out and walk. I shall never get there if this goes on." "I'll do all that can be done, sir," said Jerry. "I think we shall be in time. This block-up cannot last much longer, and your luggage is very heavy for you to carry, sir." Just then the cart in front of us began to move on, and then we had a good turn. In and out we went as fast as horse flesh could do it, and for a wonder, we had a good clear time on London Bridge, for there was a whole train of cabs and carriages all going our way at a quick trot, perhaps wanting to catch that very train. At any rate, with many others we whirled into the station just as the great clock pointed to 12:08. "Thank God we're in time," said the young man, "and thank you too, my friend, and your good horse. You have saved me more than money can ever pay for. Take this extra half-crown." "No, sir, no, thank you all the same. So glad we hit the time, sir. But don't stay now, sir. The bell is ringing. Here, porter, take this gentleman's luggage. Dover line, 12:00 train. That's it." And without waiting for another word, Jerry wheeled me round to make room for other cabs that were dashing up at the last minute and draw up on one side till the crush was past. "So glad," he said. "So glad. Poor young fellow. I wonder what it was that made him so anxious." Jerry often talked to himself, quite loud enough for me to hear when we were not moving. On Jerry's return to the rank there was a good deal of laughing and chaffing at him for driving hard to the train for an extra fare, as they said, all against his principles, and they wanted to know how much he had pocketed. "A good deal more than I generally get," said he, nodding slyly. "What he gave me will keep me in little comforts for several days." "Gammon," said one. "He's a humbug," said another, "preaching to us and then doing the same himself." "Look here, mates," said Jerry. "The gentleman offered me 1/2 crown extra, but I didn't take it. 'Twas quite pay enough for me to see how glad he was to catch that train. And if Jack and I choose to have a quick run now and then to please ourselves, that's our business and not yours." "Well," said Larry, "you'll never be a rich man." "Most likely not," said Jerry. "But I don't know that I shall be the less happy for that. I have heard the commandments read a great many times, and I never noticed that any of them said, 'Thou shalt be rich.' And there are a good many curious things said in the New Testament about rich men that, I think, would make me feel rather queer if I was one of them." "If you ever do get rich," said Governor Grant, looking over his shoulder across the top of his cab, "you'll deserve it, Jerry, and you won't find a curse come with your wealth. As for you, Larry, you'll die poor. You spend too much in whipcord." "Well," said Larry, "what is a feller to do if his horse won't go without it?" "You never take the trouble to see if he will go without it. Your whip is always going as if you had the St. Vitus's dance in your arm. And if it does not wear you out, it wears your horse out. You know you're always changing your horses. And why? Because you never give them any peace or encouragement." "Well, I have not had any good luck," said Larry. "That's where it is." "And you never will," said the Governor. "Good luck is rather particular with whom she rides, and mostly prefers those who have common sense and a good heart. At least, that's in my experience." Governor Grant turned round again to his newspaper, and the other men went to their cabs. Chapter 36. The Sunday Cab. One morning, as Jerry had just put me into the shafts and was fastening the traces, a gentleman walked into the yard. "Your servant, sir," said Jerry. "Good morning, Mr. Barker," said the gentleman. "I should be glad to make some arrangement with you for taking Mrs. Briggs regularly to church on Sunday mornings. We go to the new church now, and that is rather farther than she can walk." "Thank you, sir," said Jerry,
but I have only taken out a 6 days' licence, and therefore I could not take a fare on a Sunday. It would not be legal.
Oh, said the other, I did not know yours was a 6 days' cab. But of course it would be very easy to alter your licence. I would see that you did not lose by it. The fact is, Mrs. Briggs very much prefers you to drive her.
I should be glad to oblige the lady, sir, but I had a 7 days' licence once, and the work was too hard for me, and too hard for my horses. Year in and year out, not a day's rest, never a Sunday with my wife and children, and never able to go to a place of worship, which I had always been used to do before I took to the driving box. So for the last 5 years, I have taken only a 6 days' licence, and I find it better all the way round.
Well, of course, replied Mr. Briggs, it is very proper that every person should have rest and be able to go to church on Sundays. But I should have thought you would not have minded such a short distance for the horse, and only once a day. You would have all the afternoon and evening for yourself, and we are very good customers, you know.
Yes, sir, that is true, and I'm grateful for all favours, I am sure, and anything that I could do to oblige you or the lady, I should be proud and happy to do. But I can't give up my Sundays, sir. Indeed I can't. I read that God made man, and he made horses and all other beasts, and as soon as he had made them, he made a day of rest, and bade that all should rest 1 day in 7. I think, sir, he must have known what was good for them, and I am sure it is good for me. I am stronger and healthier altogether now that I have a day of rest. The horses are fresh too, and do not wear up nearly so fast. The 6 day drivers all tell me the same, and I have laid more money in the savings bank than ever I did before. And as for my wife and children, sir, why, heart alive, they would not go back to the 7 days' work for all they could get by it.
Oh, very well, said the gentleman. Don't trouble yourself, Mr. Barker, any further. I will inquire somewhere else. And he walked away.
Well, said Jerry to me, we can't help it, Jack, old boy. We must have our Sundays.
Polly! He shouted. Polly, come here.
She was there in a minute.
What's it all about, Jerry?
Why, my dear, Mr. Briggs wants me to take Mrs. Briggs to church every Sunday morning. I said I had only a 6 days' licence. He said, get a 7 days' licence and I'll make it worth your while. And you know, Polly, they are very good customers to us. Mrs. Briggs often goes out shopping for hours or makes calls, and then she pays down fair and honourable like a lady. There's no beating down or making 3 hours into 2 hours and a half, as some folks do. Besides, it is easy work for the horses, not like tearing along to catch trains for people that are always a quarter of an hour too late. If I don't oblige her in this matter, it is very likely we shall lose them altogether. What do you say, little woman?
I say, Jerry, says she, speaking very slowly, I say, if Mrs. Briggs would give you a sovereign every Sunday morning, I would not have you a 7 days' cabman again. We have known what it was to have no Sundays, and now we know what it is to call them our own. Thank God! You earn enough to keep us, though it is sometimes close work to pay for all the oats and hay in addition to the licence and the rent. But Harry will soon be earning something, and I would rather struggle on harder than we do than go back to those horrid times when you hardly had a minute to look at your own children, and we never could go to a place of worship together or have a happy, quiet day. God forbid that we should ever turn back to those times. That's what I say, Jerry.
And that is just what I told Mr. Briggs, my dear, said Jerry, and that is what I mean to stick to. So don't go and fret yourself, Polly, for she had begun to cry. I would not go back to the old times if I earned twice as much. So that is settled, little woman. Now, cheer up, and I'll be off to the stand.
3 weeks had passed away after this conversation, and no order had come from Mrs. Briggs, so there was nothing but taking jobs from the stand. Jerry took it to heart a good deal, for of course the work was harder for horse and man. But Polly would always cheer him up and say, "Never mind, father, never mind. Do your best and leave the rest. 'Twill all come right some day or night." It soon became known that Jerry had lost his best customer, and for what reason? Most of the men said he was a fool, but two or three took his part. If working men don't stick to their Sunday, said Truman, they'll soon have none left. It is every man's right, and every beast's right. By God's law we have a day of rest, and by the law of England we have a day of rest.
and I say we ought to hold to the rights these laws give us and keep them for our children."
"All very well for you religious chaps to talk so," said Larry, "but I'll turn a shilling when I can. I don't believe in religion, for I don't see that your religious people are any better than the rest."
"If they're not better," put in Jerry, "it is because they're not religious. You might as well say that our country's laws are not good because some people break them. If a man gives way to his temper and speaks evil of his neighbour and does not pay his debts, he is not religious. I don't care how much he goes to church. If some men are shams and humbugs, that does not make religion untrue. Real religion is the best and the truest thing in the world, and the only thing that can make a man really happy or make the world any better."
"If religion was good for anything," said Jones, "it would prevent your religious people from making us work on Sundays, as you know many of them do. And that's why I say religion is nothing but a sham. Why, if it was not for the church and the chapel goers, it would be hardly worth our coming out on a Sunday. But they have their privileges, as they call them, and I go without. I shall expect them to answer for my soul if I can't get a chance of saving it."
Several of the men applauded this, till Jerry said, "That may sound well enough, but it won't do. Every man must look after his own soul. You can't lay it down at another man's door like a foundling and expect him to take care of it. And don't you see, if you're always sitting in your box waiting for a fare, they will say, 'If we don't take him, someone else will,' and he does not look for any Sunday. Of course they don't go to the bottom of it, or they would see if they never came for a cab, it would be no use your standing there. But people don't always like to go to the bottom of things. It may not be convenient to do it, but if you Sunday drivers would all strike for a day of rest, the thing would be done. And what would all the good people do if they could not get to their favourite preachers?" said Larry. "'Tis not for me to lay down plans for other people," said Jerry, "but if they can't walk so far, they can go to what is nearer. And if it should rain, they can put on their mackintoshes as they do on a weekday. If a thing is right, it can be done, and if it is wrong, it can be done without. And a good man will find a way, and that is as true for us cabmen as it is for churchgoers."